Yeah. So just a reminder, I gave you an assignment yesterday, and I would like you to hand that in if you haven't handed it in. How difficult was the assignment yesterday?
Not hard at all.
Once I concentrated on it, it was fine.
Wow, once you concentrated on it, get it? Once you concentrated
I didn't even think about that.
You would like me to explain the joke? Wouldn't that make it more funny?
Yes.
Yeah. You see, concentration is a chemistry term referring to how close are the molecules together.
Because you know if you explain the joke,
it makes it, yeah, I know. That's the joke. I'm explaining it, and that makes it inherently not.
It cancels out.
Okay, listen up. So we're going to talk about titrations, pH curves, buffers, indicators, stuff like that today. I don't know if you remember back to chemistry 20 when you were doing a titration. What is a titration? Boss, a titration is a titration. Okay. Max?
When you slowly add something that will change what's in the bottom, but you have to be real precise about it.
Yeah, you gotta be real precise about it, right? You're basically adding one chemical to another chemical, and you are trying to get a chemical reaction, right? You're trying to do something to that first chemical. And there has to be some sort of an indication when the chemical reaction is over, right? So typically we use an indicator to indicate when the end of the reaction will be. So just by way of an example, in Chem 20, you often use titrations to be able to determine the concentration of an acid or a base. So what's the concentration of this thing? You had to use an indicator to identify it. So for example, here we've got a setup. I've got a burette with an Erlenmeyer flask. We've got a sample and a titrant, okay? So up here, we've got our titrant. And in this example, what is the titrant made out of? It's made out of a base. The titrant is always what you're doing something with, okay? So it's with 0.10 mole per liter sodium hydroxide. Remember, is sodium hydroxide really sodium hydroxide?
No.
Sodium ions and hydroxide ions. So really, this isn't really 0.1 mole per liter sodium hydroxide. What is it? It's 0.1 mole per liter hydroxide. That's what we care about. The sodium, nobody cares about. Sodium's a spectator ion, doesn't do anything. It just kind of floats around in solution, and it bumps off of things and bumps into something else. It doesn't do anything. What's our sample? So we've got the titrant. We're adding the titrant to a sample. And what's our sample in this case? It's a sample of 0.10 mole per liter hydrochloric acid. Is hydrochloric acid really hydrochloric acid? No. What's in hydrochloric acid that we care about? It's hydronium, right? Hydrochloric acid reacts with water to make hydronium and chloride ions, but it's hydronium that we care about. Now, the sample usually has a very specific volume to it. This is going to have a very specific volume, and in this case, it's 25.0 milliliters. Do you remember how do we get such a precise volume of our sample?
We pipette it.
It's the thing with the bulb, right?
and you pull up the solution, and that if you make a mistake, all the liquid goes into the bulb, and then you really, really, really enrage your chemistry teacher by pulling the solution into the bulb. Do you remember that? No? Okay. You and I must have had very different chemistry teachers, but that's okay. We're going to move on, okay? So from this, right, we're adding an unspecified volume of this, right? It's a variable volume. So as the level of the solution drops, we can read what was the change in volume, and we can figure out how much we added. So let's take a look at what a very typical titration curve looks like. As with any graph, we have to have a title, we have to have axis labels, okay, no problem. This is the titration of hydrochloric acid with sodium hydroxide. So what's our titrant and what's our sample? The titrant is the NaOH and the sample is the hydrochloric acid. So where are we gonna start? At the beginning, we're measuring the pH. We're measuring the pH inside our sample. What's the pH going to be inside our sample? Is it acidic or basic?
Acidic.
It's acidic, so it's going to be a low pH, right? Let's start it off here, just down there, whatever, it doesn't really matter. And then slowly, the pH is going to increase, and the pH is going to increase. And then all of a sudden it's going to rise really swiftly. So let's, okay. Does this make sense? That we're adding a base to an acid, so we're slowly raising the pH. But then because this is a logarithmic curve, pH stands for power of hydrogen, right? So this is a logarithmic curve. At some point in time, we end up as an artifact of it being logarithmic. We get like this huge spike in the pH, and then it levels off really, really quickly, okay? That's because of the logarithmic function that we're using that we define our pH to be. Okay, at what pH is the end of the reaction? 13? At what pH is the end of the reaction, Jordy?
I'm just going to say 7.
Why? Because are you done the titration here? I mean, that's when you stopped adding base, but is that the end of the experiment? No, where was the end of the experiment? I'm going to show you a little trick on how you get that end of the experiment. Do you kind of see how, if we were to continue this line going, if we were to continue it, it'd kind of go like that.
Yeah.
And if we were to continue this line backwards, it'd kind of go like that. And if, they should be roughly parallel. And if we chose the absolute middle between those two lines, what would it be?
7.
Man, how good is that? I'm such a good artist. So here, our end point, or our equivalence point, there is a difference between those two terms. It's 7 in this particular reaction, okay? Now let's take a look at this. Let's write the Bronsted-Lowry reaction for the reaction between sodium hydroxide and hydrochloric acid. What do you always start off a Bronsted-Lowry reaction with? Major entities in solution. So let's do that. The major entities in solution. What two things are you adding to each other? So it's hydrochloric acid. Does hydrochloric acid exist in water?
No.
Sure doesn't. H3O plus and chloride. Okay, so we got hydrochloric acid is actually hydronium. And then what about sodium hydroxide? Does that actually exist?
Sodium.
Hydroxide.
Sodium.
And then what do we always have in solution?
Water.
Are you sick of me asking you that?
Yeah.
Yeah, you are. Deal with it. Okay, here we go. So now what do? We listed our major entities. Before we go on to write the reaction, what do we have to do here?
Identify our
strongest acid and strongest base. Hopefully this is super easy. You don't even need a data booklet for this. What's the strongest acid that can exist in water? Hydronium. What's the strongest base that can exist in water? OH. So we write a reaction. We write a reaction where the strongest acid, H3O, donates a proton to the strongest base. And I'm gonna write a quantitative arrow. Is that okay? Because this is greater than 99%. This is like 100% reaction. It's not, but hopefully you know what I mean. It like basically is, right? Do I say that a lot? Do I say like a lot?
Like,
just watch the video.
Just watch the video.
Play
back.
A drinking game.
Yeah. I'm definitely not going to play a drinking game in my video. Thank you very much. As much as I appreciate the recommendation. Okay, let's try and identify an indicator. Hey, do you remember how to figure out what indicator you want to use here? Do you remember what indicator you want to use? What?
I don't know. I don't guess.
What did you say?
I said phenylphthalein.
Phenylphthalein. Let's see if she's right. Why did you say phenylphthalein, Sanjana?
I don't know, because we used it last year.
Because you used it a lot last year. Do I have to separate you two?
No, we're good.
Yeah? It doesn't look like you're good.
We'll be fine.
Okay. It was, okay, let's look at this. Phenylphthalein. Where does the change in color occur? Between what two pHs does the change in color occur in phenylphthalein? 8.2 and 10. And we want our equivalence point to fall in between those two things. Does our equivalence point, does this fall in between 8.2 and 10?
No.
No bueno. So this thing is the equivalence point. So what do you want to use? Could you use phenol red?
Yes.
Yes, that would be totally fine. Karoma. Okay, then we're going to define something here in a little bit, the difference between the end point and the equivalence point. The equivalence point is when you have exactly equal concentrations, or amounts, sorry, not concentrations. It's when you have exactly equal amounts of this and this. I want to be very clear. The equivalence point is a totally hypothetical point. You cannot stop at the equivalence point. Because at the equivalence point, there's equal numbers of molecules of this and molecules of that, or ions of this and ions of that. Do you think you could stop exactly? I'll just put a 1/1,000,000th of a drop of water in there, and I'll get exactly this many ions and exactly that many ions.
No, probably not.
The second you add a quarter of a drop, you add another 20 trillion of this. So you're only off by 20 trillion. That's not bad, right? You know what I mean? Okay, so the equivalence point is a totally hypothetical point. That's where we have equal amounts of the acid and base. We use, Karoma, the end point as a visual indicator of when the end of the reaction occurs. That's what we use. Okay? So which one of these would be appropriate for an endpoint? Could I use phenol red as an endpoint for this reaction? Yes. Could I use bromothymol blue? Yes. Could I use chlorophenol red?
No,
it's outside. It's just barely outside. Maj, are you doing okay? I guess the more appropriate question is, Denver, is Maj bothering you?
I mean, it's fine.
It's fine for now. It's bothering me, I know that. So we could have used phenol red. Or bromothymol blue. That's a Chem 20 outcome. We're not really going to focus a ton on it, but they will ask you about that on the diploma. That's like a continuation that they're expecting you to know. Okay, like we said before, the equivalence point of a titration is the point where you have equivalent or equal chemical amounts of titrant and sample or analyte. It is impossible to stop exactly at the equivalence point. That's not physically possible. You cannot have exactly 20 trillion and one of this and 20 trillion and one of that. It's never going to happen. At some point, it could happen, but stopping at it is not going to happen. We often use an indicator to identify approximately when the equivalence occurs. That's called the endpoint. So what you see in the lab is the endpoint. What you read on a graph is the equivalence point. Are we okay with that?
Yeah.
But often those terms are used like synonymously with each other. We can exchange them, and we shouldn't. So what I want you to do is I want you to figure out, this is, do you remember what a polyprotic substance is?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's Chem 20?
Two hydrogens.
Two or more hydrogens, but in separate chemical reactions, right?
Yes.
If a substance can donate more than one hydrogen or accept more than one hydrogen in separate chemical reactions. So I want you to figure out where the endpoints would be. Where would the equivalence points be, and then what indicator would we use? First of all, how many equivalence points do you see in this graph?
Two.
I see two, right? One here and one there. I want you to use the lines, figure out where they are, and then identify what indicators you can use. So draw the lines and figure out the halfway point between those lines. Draw the lines and identify the halfway point between those lines to figure out what indicator you want to use. Does anybody need a data booklet? No. We just have some people too lazy to get it out. Corona?
Who decided to name this?
Straightforward.
I'm off a thing.
I think. Thing.
Who decided to name it that?
Kind of went up on that. So I understand that these lines are not parallel with each other. I get that. But we're still going to try and find the midpoint of them. So what is this pH for the second equivalence point? What pH is that approximately?
9.9.
Yeah, let's call it 9.9. And then what about for the first equivalence point? What's that?
That's like 4.8.
That's like 4 point, right? If 5 is here, 4. Yeah, I'm gonna call it 4.7.
Oh.
Yeah, in your face. Here we go. Okay. So for the first one, what would be an appropriate indicator for the first one? Bromocresol green would be fine, right? Would methyl orange be okay? Nope. Would methyl red be okay?
Up to a certain extent. I mean, if you use mine at
what?
Then it's fine.
I would say the indicator you would want, the equivalence point pH you want to fall relatively in the middle of that range. It is okay if you get it to fall on the very edge of that range, but it's, I mean, I wrote down 4.7, so.
I mean, yeah, it's true.
Okay, so basically bromocresol green is the only one that we can use for this one. Bromocresol green. And then for the second one, what did you say? Phenolphthalein, right? Everybody say it with me. Phenolphthalein. It's an FTH right after each other, right? It's really easy, don't worry about it. So phenolphthalein or what?
Thymolphthalein.
I don't even know if I'm spelling it right, but whatever, that's fine. Okay, let's look at bromocresol green. What color is it going to be at the beginning of the experiment?
Yellow.
It's going to be yellow? And what's it going to turn into?
Blue. It's going to be like,
definitely green.
Blue. Do we need to go back to like green two?
Okay, I think the problem is I didn't word the question appropriately enough. What color are we going to start at?
Yellow.
Eventually, what color are we going to turn into?
Blue.
And at the equivalence point or at the end point, what color is it going to be?
Green.
See, I just need to ask the appropriate question.
I was going
to
say,
you're all on the right page. We're good to go. Don't worry about it. Okay.
Yeah, the end point.
Yellow and blue.
No, but it's green. End point is
blue. We don't know where it's blue.
Down here, it's going to be yellow, right? And then way up here, it's going to be blue. But at the equivalence point. That's okay. Everybody gets one. It's okay. Indicators are chemicals that have acidic or basic components to them. An indicator, like thymolphthalein, is an acid or a base. It's an acid, and it's a base. It's reacting based on the conditions of whether the solution is acidic or basic.
Does that mean they're all amphiprotic?
No, it doesn't mean they're amphiprotic, because amphiprotic means that one entity could either accept a proton or give away a proton, right? No, but it's we're saying that the chemical, when it's in its protonated form, when it's in its deprotonated form, it could accept a proton. So if there's only two entities that a substance could be, it can't be amphiprotic. There needs to be three versions of that entity in order for it to be amphiprotic. It's in the middle, so it can either accept a proton or give away a proton,
okay.
If that makes sense. There are some indicators that are amphiprotic. So, these indicators, they react just like acids and bases do. They react exactly like acids and bases do. We usually use a two-letter combination because if we were to write out the chemical formula for the whole thing, it'd be a huge nightmare. It'd just be so big and so long that it would be incomprehensible. So, bromothymol blue turns from yellow to blue when added to a solution of sodium hydroxide. So, what I want you to understand is this is the chemical formula for bromothymol blue when it's at its low pH version. Are we okay with that?
Yeah.
So this is tied in with anything below 6.0, they'll all be in this version. But slowly, as we add sodium hydroxide, then it turns into this version above a pH of 7.6. In the middle, we just have both things available. In the middle, in between those two pHs, we've got a little bit of this and a little bit of this. So what's the color? What's the color of, and I'm totally giving it away, what's the color of HBB?
Yellow.
It's yellow. So this thing is yellow. And what's the color of BB minus?
Blue.
Blue. This thing is blue. And so if we're in between these two pH ranges, if we're in between, we've got a little bit of this present and a little bit of that present. What happens when you have a little bit of yellow and a little bit of blue present? You end up getting green. Does that make sense? That's the reason why this is, okay? Now, indicators, because indicators are acids and bases, they also have a Ka. They also have a Ka. I could ask you, if you had this concentration of bromothymal blue, I could get you to predict what the pH of the solution would be. So anyways, I need you to understand that. Okay, write the reaction of phenol red as it turns red to yellow following the addition of a strong acid. What the hell is going on here? Let's look at phenol red and let's see what's going on as it goes from red to yellow. Phenol red.
Yellow.
It goes yellow to red, but what are we adding to this mixture of phenol red?
A strong acid.
So we're starting at a high pH, and we're going to a low pH. If we're starting at a high pH, what version of phenol red do we have? Do we have HPR or PR minus?
We've
got PR minus, right? So we've got PR minus reacting with a strong acid. When I add a strong acid, what's in a strong acid?
Hydronium.
So we're adding hydronium to it. So we've got an acid reacting with the base, so we're going to get HPR and H2O. Does it kind of show you, does this illustrate to you how we're going from one color to the other? What's the color of PR minus? The color of PR minus is red. And what's the color of HPR? Yellow. So let's try and figure this out. Let's use Le Chatelier's principle. It's been a while since we've done that. Let's use Le Chatelier's principle. And let's add to this equilibrium, let's add more hydronium. What's going to happen to the color of the mixture when we add more hydronium? Yep, so we're going to increase this side and shift to the product side. So what happens? When we add hydronium, the concentration of PR minus goes down, but the concentration of HPR goes up. So we get less red and more yellow. Are we okay with that?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. No problem. I want you to write the reaction of thymol blue as it reacts with a strong base to turn from yellow to blue. What color are we starting at?
Yellow.
Starting at yellow.
If it's
transitioning from yellow to blue, but it looks green, you must have relatively equal amounts of both, right? So what we must be close to the equivalence point.
Yeah.
Nope.
What is thymol blue when it's yellow? When it's yellow form, what does thymol blue look like? So it's H negative, right? Yep. So you have to have H and B negative. And hydroxide is negative. It has to be negative. So you have to put OH negative. It's just that we've got two negative things reacting with each other.
Okay. So here's the problem. When hopefully you recognize that when we're looking at thymol blue, thymol blue is polyprotic. It has the ability to give away two different hydrogens, right? So that means HTB minus is amphiprotic, right? Because HTB minus could accept a proton and HTB minus could give away a proton. Are we okay with that? But what color are we starting out as?
Yellow.
So what version of TB something? What version are we using?
HTB
negative. Please do not forget that, right? So we're starting out with HTB negative. And we're adding a strong base. Well, what the hell is a strong base made of?
Hydroxide.
And what are we going to make?
TB negative.
We're going to make TB2 negative plus water. And what is the color? I know that I'm kind of paying a little bit more attention than I should be. Well, what is the color of HTB negative?
Yellow.
That's the worst yellow in the world, but whatever. And then what's the color of TB2 negative?
Blue.
And if I stop where we have an equal amount of this and an equal amount of this, then yellow and blue make green. That's the reason why that solution becomes green at one. Okay. So polyprotic, real quickly. A polyprotic acid, you covered this in Chem 20 already, but I need to go over it. A polyprotic acid is a substance that can donate more than one proton. Let's talk about an example. Let's look at our H2SO4. Is H2SO4 polyprotic?
I don't know.
Yes.
We have to be able to write two different reactions.
Oh, I meant S.
No. You were right, Max. Oh. Yeah. It's okay. Okay. H2SO4. Can it give away one proton? Yes. Then we look for HSO4. Can HSO4 negative, can it also give away a proton?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So we call it polyprotic because it has the ability to give away more than one hydrogen, but keep in mind they're in separate reactions. So H2SO4 plus water. And I'm going to use a quantitative arrow because it's a strong acid. Liquid. It'll react with water to give hydronium and the hydrogen sulfate ion. Then, if you took that hydrogen sulfate and you did something to it again, why did I write it like that? Let's say this time you react it with hydroxide. Then you can rip off another hydrogen and you get the sulfate ion. So it's polyprotic because it can give away more than one hydrogen in totally separate reactions. A polyprotic base is a substance that can accept more than one proton in separate reactions.
I mean, if that counts,
the Ca calcium, let's write down calcium hydroxide, right? 2 plus. So calcium hydroxide is polyprotic as well, right? Because it can make 2 hydroxides. No?
Yes.
I'm just saying no.
You're saying no?
Yes.
Because I'm hesitant and I'm pausing?
Yeah. Yes.
Because I'm leading you?
Because... Yeah, that's exactly.
What were the words that I said? If for those of you who are like hyper paying attention, a polyprotic base is a substance that can accept more than one proton. Can this substance accept more than one proton? Like... the 2 hydroxides, can they each accept a proton?
Yeah.
Yes.
They can each accept a proton. Okay, but here's the problem, is that this substance in particular is not polyprotic. I need you to understand that. This is not polyprotic. What did I say immediately after I said this sentence? Polyprotic base is a substance that can accept more than one proton
in separate chemical reactions.
So I was leading you because I want you to know, I need you to know that this is not polyprotic. Now, I'm gonna be a little bit of a jerk, and I'm gonna say specifically OH minus. Is OH minus itself, is that entity polyprotic?
Yeah.
Can it accept more than one proton in subsequent reactions?
Yeah. Oh, that is
a... Yeah, if this thing reacts with water, we end up getting what? H2O and hydroxide again, right? But I want to be very specific. Did this hydroxide, did it accept a proton? Yes. Now let's take the water. Can that water also accept a proton?
Yes.
Yes, it can.
Combine it with water.
So we can take that water, and let's react it with, let's react it with H2SO3, for example.
Why not water?
Why not water? Let's do it with water. Why not water? No. So the water is going to accept a proton, and it's going to turn into H3O plus and HSO3 minus. Whoa, that's the worst thing. So let's take a look at this. Hydroxide went from hydroxide to water, and then the water went from water to hydronium. Did it accept more than one proton? Yes. So it's polyprotic. How can you tell if something's polyprotic? Not if it's on the thing twice. So if, let's take a look at H2SO3. H2SO3, can it act as an acid? Can it give away a proton? All right, then let's look for HSO3 minus again. Let's look for that product somewhere else. So HSO3 minus, can it itself act as an acid? It can give away a proton. So that means that first substance was polyprotic, right? Usually, a polyprotic substance will have an amphiprotic conjugate acid or conjugate base. I don't know if that totally made sense, but that's what we're going to stick with, okay? This is what a titration of a polyprotic substance looks like. How many equivalence points do we have here?
Two.
One right here. One right here. I'm asking you,
Why is there more than one equivalence point? Because it's polyprotic. This is the substance. First of all, are we starting with an acid or a base? So this is the base accepting the first proton, and then this is the base accepting the second proton. What base are we talking about here? Let's look at any polyprotic base that you want. Find a polyprotic base on that sheet. Find something that turns into something that can also act as a base. I'll give you a hint. You should look kind of low in the list. What?
Hydrogen carbonate.
Okay. Are you saying hydrogen carbonate, or are you saying the conjugate base of hydrogen carbonate? So you're talking about carbonate.
Yeah.
Okay. Can carbonate accept two different protons? Yes, it can. So let's call this carbonate. Let's say here we've got a carbonate ion. That's when we start with the carbonate ion. And then what are we adding to the carbonate ion? We're adding acid. So we're getting an acid reacting with carbonate, and it turns into hydrogen carbonate. So there are two reactions. Why is there more than one equivalence point? There are two reactions. And I want to say subsequent reactions, but we could say in a row, right? In a row, one after the other. The first reaction. Let's look at this graph. What's my sample? What do I start with? Carbonate. And what am I usually adding to a base? A strong acid, right? So what are we going to add to this base? Hydronium, right? That strong acid. So we're going to take CO3, 2-, and we're adding hydronium to it. And I'll just use equilibrium arrows because I want to. So we get one proton transfers to the carbonate. We get hydrogen carbonate and water. Then that's the first reaction, right? That's happening in the first section. So can we just label that? Everywhere here, all the way up to there, that's reaction number one. You can think of it, that's the reaction that's happening at the first equivalence point. And then we've got a second reaction happening. Okay, so our carbonate reacted with all of the acid that I added, right? It reacted with all of the acid, and it 100% turned into hydrogen carbonate. What do we continue to do every single second of this titration? What do we continue to do all the time? Adding more acid, more and more acid. So we used up all the acid up until that point, but we're adding more acid, and we're adding more acid, and the acid never completely goes away. So what's our strongest base that we have left over after that first reaction is done? Hydrogen carbonate is our strongest base that we have left over. And what's the strongest acid that we're always adding all the time? Hydronium. You don't run out of this stuff. It's a titration. You're adding more and more and more every time. We're going to get H2CO3, and then we're also going to get water. Interesting fact about H2CO3, the second you start making H2CO3, you know immediately why.
Bubbles.
It's going to start to bubble. I want you to look at your data booklet. Look for carbonic acid.
Thank you.
When I look at carbonic acid, every time I make carbonic acid, it immediately starts to decompose into two different things. Water and what? Carbon dioxide. The second you make carbonic acid, it starts to fizzle. That's why when you open up a pop, there's tons of carbonic acid in there, and it starts to fizzle and give off carbon dioxide. So that's how you know. Anytime you make carbonic acid, you're going to make carbon dioxide. Jordy.
What's stopping the CO to carbonate?
Yeah.
Like, why isn't it just getting two one, like two quick?
Okay, so let's say
the delay between both.
Okay. So let's say, Jordy, that we kind of stopped halfway in that first reaction, right? So we turned some of the CO3 2 minus. We turned some of it into HCO3 minus,
yeah.
And we're always adding more hydronium, more and more and more. It never goes away. You can never get enough of your titrate. So you've got a mixture of these two things, mm-hmm. and your hydronium. What's going to react with what?
They're both
going to
have hydronium.
Nope. Your strongest base is going to react with your strongest acid, right?
Yeah.
So just because this is here, I get it that this is a base, right? It totally could accept a proton. But what's going to happen is that you're going to have this thing is going to react with that way before this does, because it's a stronger base. It wants that proton more. Is that okay? That's a very, very good question. Are we okay with this? Yeah. Okay, so let's write the indicators of these equivalence points, and then let's write the Bronsted-Lowry reactions at these points. You gotta go, you gotta go. First of all, what are we starting with?
Base.
A base. We're starting with what base? Na2CO3. Is Na2CO3 really Na2CO3?
No.
No, it's Na and it's CO3. But I want you to figure out what two indicators we would use. And if you want to move on to the other equations or to the other reactions, I'm letting you know right now, we just dealt with carbonate, right? We just talked about carbonate. So instead of carbonate, let's talk about oxalate. So I'm changing this to sodium oxalate instead of sodium carbonate. But it doesn't change your first task. Your first task is figure out what indicators you want to use. Once you've written down which indicators you want to use, I want you to write the first Bronsted-Lowry equivalence reaction, so the reaction up until that point, and then I want you to write the reaction up until the next one, and then we can add the two together and we can figure out the overall. Everyone's going to see something slightly different. I 100% agree. That's why on your diploma exam, you're going to have grid lines that are super easy to follow, and it's going to be a multiple choice question, right?
Yeah.
And it's going to say either this indicator or like this indicator. And it's gonna, they're going to be totally different. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's not, you don't have to like guess and...
Nah, this is you telling me, I think this indicator would work, right?
Okay.
Yeah. Oh man, that's terrible. Oh, boy.
Max.
Is there a like a C-O-C-C-O-O in the table? A C-O-C-C-O-O? There's an H-O-O-C-C-O-O, right?
This thing
can accept two protons, one on the right hand side and one on the left hand side.
There's an
H-O-O-C-C-O-O minus.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's after it's accepted one proton. And then it can accept another proton as well.
Right.
So since sodium is a spectator ion, would we write that in the no?
Nope.
Okay.
Doesn't do anything. Go ahead and write the reaction.
It's an acid? Oxalate is an acid?
Say it's at least 7.
So you're looking at the same.
Yep. That would be okay. I would probably pick this one because 7.5 is almost
kind of those.
It's okay. I'll just take it.
That's
really
yep.
Oxalate ion is equal to
base.
Would I add
hydroxyl? I don't know what you're adding to this. Starting with titration up so that
if we're adding chlorine,
if he wasn't in line,
would
you just cut it?
Would that be we're adding chlorine?
No. No, you're adding hydrochloric acid, and that splits up into hydronium. So you're adding chloride, which is suspected.
Okay.
Because it's the base, the conjugate base is strong acid. And these find the bases up here never they never exist. They're not strong enough bases.
Okay.
Kate, you might get a different number than I do. You might get a little bit of a different indicator than I do. I got my equivalence point at just over 8. How many people got it below 8?
I said 8.
You got it right around 8. Okay. So there's a little bit of discrepancy. I want you to understand that if your answer doesn't match the answer in like one of the two answers on the diploma, then probably you kind of misplaced your point. I have this right in the middle of those. I'm pretty happy with that. Around 8 would be fine. So we're saying phenol red or maybe phenolphthalein or something. There's a little bit of a break in the really low 8 range. There's not many indicators in there, so this is a tough question, Jordan.
Cresol red?
Yes.
Is that one of those polyprotic ones at the top?
Yeah.
Yeah, that would work. Yeah, so that's a good point, because Cresol red has two endpoints, right? So it's got a nice one. What is it, 7.0 to 8.8? Yeah, so this is right in the middle of that. Okay, and then an indicator for equivalence number 2. This is like 4.5. So what's that? Bromo-cresol green. Bromo-cresol green. Okay. So, this is the part that I need you to understand, because this is the part that a lot of people really, really have trouble with. The reaction, when I say at equivalence point number one, I mean up until equivalence point number one. That's what I mean. So what do we have right at the beginning? Yeah, we have sodium oxalate. Sodium, I hope you understand, sodium doesn't do anything. So it's really oxalate, OOCCOO2 minus. And because we're adding a strong acid, we're adding hydronium. Bossa, do you make it for me? Oh, okay. Thought I heard somebody hydronium.
That was Jonas.
Oh, that was Jonas. So we get HOOCCOO minus and water. And then the Bronsted-Lowry reaction and equivalence point number two. So up until this point, we've used up, at the equivalence point, we've totally ran out of OOCCOO2 minus. We totally ran out of it. So after that point, what's the next strongest base in our mixture?
Hydrogen oxalate.
So now we're starting with hydrogen oxalate. And what do we never run out of? We never run out of our hydronium. Why do we never run out of hydronium?
Because
you're adding it, right? With that burette, you're constantly adding more and more and more. So we get HOOCCOOH. That's okay. This is the way we write it in the data booklet. Is it wrong to write H2OOCCOO?
Yes.
It's not wrong. What do you say? HOOCHCOO. It would take me a really long time to figure out what the hell you were trying to say, but I'd probably be okay with it.
H2O4C2.
Okay, I want to make sure we're all on the same page. Whenever I do an overall reaction, I add reaction 1 to reaction 2. And some things, anything that's in common on both the products and the reactant side, we can cross out. So if I were to add all of the products up, if I added all the products up, and then I added all the products up and all the reactants up, is there anything that could cancel once I added those up? Okay, well let's just do it, okay? So I've got AOO, damn it. OOCCOO2 minus plus how many hydroniums am I reacting in total? When I add all the reactants together, plus 2H3O plus. But what else do I have on the reactant side? I've got 1HOOCCOO plus. I'm going to write it over here, HOOCCOO minus. So I've basically got those three entities kind of reacting together. One, when I add these reactions together, and I've got HOOCCOO minus plus 2 waters plus HOOCCOOH. Okay, why am I doing this? This is an overall reaction. Reaction together. When we add reactions together, we add the reactants together and we add the products together. So hopefully you can see that this is almost like a subtotal of what's happened here, and this is a subtotal of what's happened here. Is there anything that we can cancel out? So, what? Matt?
Hydronium.
The hydronium cannot cancel out. The hydrogen oxalate.
That thing.
And the hydrogen oxalate can cancel out.
Whoa.
Do you kind of see how it's only... The hydrogen oxalate is like an intermediate, right? We make this, and then we immediately turn it into this. So it cancels out on both sides. Because we only have it temporarily. So what's the overall reaction?
Why can we use a shorter
two
H3O? Like, use
H2O4C2.
Chemists are just masochists, I guess. I
do it. H2O4C2.
Okay, is that okay? Like, so far we've done, we haven't really done a whole heck of a lot yet.
Does the H-O-O-C-C-O-O-H negative charge?
Does it have a negative charge?
No.
I don't know.
But then how can you
get... Okay, I don't know. When this, Preston, let's go back to the original two equations. When this thing accepts a proton, when it accepts a positive charge, it becomes negative one. And then when the negative one accepts a positive charge, it becomes no negative at all.
So is it okay if the final, if the overall reaction isn't balanced?
It is
balanced.
No, it's not.
Two.
What's the total charge on this side?
Zero.
Why? All because of the
It's a negative two and two positives.
Not his favorite dude.
Preston, that's a great question, by the way. Okay. Blah, 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 blah. Jeez Louise, holy.
I feel like we've done a lot.
I feel like we have done a lot. I feel like I need to stretch this into like 2 days.
Yeah, and then the test should be
one day.
And then the test should be no. No.
You can always finish tomorrow and then we'll review it.
Yeah, we can finish tomorrow. Yeah, we're gonna have a test on Friday. What do you mean on Thursday? There was that it did say quiz on Thursday and then I got rid of it.
No quiz.
I'm being merciful. So okay, hey, calm down. You got 10 minutes left, 9 minutes, whatever. You got 9 minutes left. You can start answering questions in your assignments or your review booklets. Yeah, I have the answer key to the review booklet.